Well, God bless you. Thank you for being here today. And the people pleaser in me wants you to go out shouting here this morning. And I always love to give a positive word, but I think there is good news today, but it's going to come through some bad news. It's going to come through I was on the sign. A whole different sermon. I thought I was going to go down that direction, and the Lord had something else for me. And I believe God gave me a picture, and it's not original with me. It's actually in the scriptures. In Hebrews 12, it says this: "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith," this is where I just had to pause even before I walked in this door for this second service, and just to understand what the Holy Spirit wanted to say to us today as a church. Let us strip off every weight that slows us down. Let us strip off every weight that slows us down. What is he talking about there? Well, in the next part it says this: especially the sin that so easily trips us up. So let us strip off every weight, every sin, everything that you and I have been allowing in our lives that is weighing you down, holding you down, that you and I have allowed. I'm throwing myself in the mix because, you know, I'm not a finished work either. God's still working on me. But I think the word is clear this morning. Strip off every weight, everything that hinders, especially the sin that so easily trips us up, and let us run with endurance the race that God has set before us. And how do we do that? By keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. I want to take us to a passage in the Old Testament, Ezekiel chapter 44. And I got the words up on the screen for that, but you can turn there. It's in the Old Testament. There was something going on in the church. They really weren't called the church in the Old Testament, but the people of God, the Israelites, the Hebrews. There was some things going on in and around the temple that God spoke through the prophet Ezekiel. Some very tough words, kind of a wake-up call. And this was sent to people who were already followers of God. They were believers, but it was a strong word. And I want us to look at it here this morning for a few minutes before we participate in communion today. So Ezekiel chapter 44, beginning with verse 10. I'm going to ask you, Josh, if you'd... maybe I can follow along here. I don't know. We'll see. All right. So Ezekiel, the prophet, is speaking to the people of God. He's going to differentiate between two groups of people, groups of priests, the spiritual leaders within the church. And he says, "The Levites who went far from me, they abandoned me when Israel went astray, and who wandered from me after their idols, they must bear the consequences of their sin." They may serve me in the sanctuary. So even though they're sin, they may serve me in the sanctuary, having charge of the gates of the temple and serving in it. They may slaughter the burnt offerings and the sacrifices for the people and stand before the people and serve them. Next verse, go ahead. I'm going to let you lead us here, Josh, on that. "They are not to come near to serve me as priests or come near any of my holy things or my most holy offerings. They must bear the shame of their detestable practices." Next verse. "They are not to come near to serve me as priests." And we already read, I'm sorry, verse 14. We already read that part. Verse 14. "And I will appoint them to guard the temple for all the work that is to be done in it." Next verse. "But the Levitical priests," here's a separate group of priests, "who are descendants of Zadok, and who guarded my sanctuary when the Israelites went astray from me, are to come near to minister before me." They are to stand before me. The other group of priests were to stand and minister to the people, but this group is to minister before me, God says. They can stand before me to offer sacrifices of fat and blood. Next verse. They alone are to enter my sanctuary. They alone are to come near my table to minister before me and serve as my guards. Then he gives some interesting instructions on what to wear. When they enter the gates of the inner court, they are to wear linen clothes. They must not wear any of the woolen garment while ministering at the gates of the inner court or inside the temple. Interesting, isn't it? It gets more interesting. Look at this. They are to wear linen turbans on their heads and linen undergarments around their waists. Linen underwear around their waists. They must not wear anything that makes them perspire. Now, some of you are wondering, where in the world are you going with this, Pastor Mike? Did your mama ever tell you, you know, especially if you're going out somewhere special, somewhere fancy, make sure you put your good underwear on. Anybody ever hear that growing up? All right. I mean, what? What's that? Well, you might get in a wreck. Well, what difference does that make, right? Who cares, right? Well, I didn't know what to call the sermon, so it's called the underwear sermon this morning. Because the underwear he's talking about, undergarments, it's close to your skin. It's really the symbolism is your personal holiness. And not to perspire, because that was part of the curse. Remember when Adam sinned? Part of the curse was, now by the sweat of your brow, you're going to toil and labor. And so the implication here is, my worshipers, when they come before me, why, my worshipers, I want you to worship in the rest and the peace of my spirit, not the human striving of effort apart from God that would make you perspire. I want you to be at peace and rest when you come before me and minister. But see, here in the text, there's a problem. I said there were two different priesthoods. The first one, group of priests, were under Eli's leadership. He was the high priest. And this is an Old Testament character, Old Testament story, Eli, but he had a very modern day problem. And that's this, that in public, Eli was recognized. He was respected. He was a priest. But in private, there were some problems. He was a mess. He had become so complacent in his requirements and in his duties as the priest. He had been in ministry so long that he had lost that intimacy with the Father. And Ezekiel is calling him out. Just like the Holy Spirit would call you and I out here this morning for sometimes how we can get complacent spiritually. We get a little numb. You're here today. Praise God. The discipline, the duty of going to church brought you here, but some of you would have to be honest and say the desire's not really there. I know I'm doing the right thing, you know. I'm with my mom and dad, or I'm with my spouse, or I just, you know, I've made the effort to get through here. I'm with my friends. I'm here, but you're here out of duty and not as much out of desire, out of discipline. And sometimes that's what it takes. You know, you don't wait till you feel like it to do it. You do it, and then you'll feel like it later. Some of you, you know, you're living into some kind of expectation. This is what a church person, this is what a Christian is supposed to be like, but you're not enjoying it. There's the expectation, but there's no joy. And here, Eli, he had lost his heart, intimacy with the Father. He viewed the Ark of the Covenant, which was like the main thing about God's presence, he viewed it as a relic, something from the past. He had lost his intimacy, and personally, he lacked a lot of self-discipline. He was overweight. He didn't take care of himself. He was lazy, and probably worst thing of all, he didn't discipline his sons. He wouldn't call his sons out for the evil, the immorality that they were living. They were sleeping with women in the church, his sons, the sons of the priests. And as I read this, I began to think of all the ministries, all the big name people that we see do on the outward just some great things, ministers and ministries. But yet behind the scenes, we come to find out later there was personal sin. And when I read this text, it's almost like personal sin does not stop the ministry. Personal sin does not immediately disqualify you from serving others. There are people that we've watched for years, maybe even the last decades, who could minister with amazing God-given gifts and even sometimes under an undeniable anointing, yet privately living in sin. I think back in the 80s, it was PTL and Jim Baker. Then it was Jimmy Swaggart. Then it was Bill Hybels, Willow Creek, and most recently, Carl Lentz, Hillsong, New York City. I mean, the list, that's just a short list of many, many people that on the outward were doing great things for God, and then you come to find out later there was those sins that so easily entangled them and kept them from running the race. And my heart for this church here today by bringing this kind of word is that even in our well-doing, and some of you gave your heart to Christ recently, you rededicated your life to Christ, and yet it's so easy to allow those things to weigh us down, that sin that so easily entangles us, because even though you've maybe made a turn for Him, guess what? The devil hasn't given up on you, and he wants to entrap you and snare you back in some of those same sins. And what I'm saying today is the same word that God was giving through Ezekiel to the people within the church, saying there's two kinds of priesthoods that we can be in this church. There's two kinds of priesthoods that we can have at Celebration. And I want you to note in this text is that the first group, that they were filled with compromise. They were not living right. Eli was not doing right. He was a mess. And the Bible says, I want you to note in this text, it says that they were still able to serve others. They could still greet people as they walked in. They could still park cars. They could still help out in the nursery. They can still usher and serve, and they can still preach, and they can still sing, and they can lead in worship. They can do all these things. They can minister to my people. But I want you to note that it says, they can't minister to me. They can only get so far. And my question to you today is, what part of the priesthood do you want to be a part of? The part that is filled with compromise? You see, I can't tell how successful you are by the size of your business or, your ministry. I mean, on the outward, and sometimes that's the only thing that people see is the outward, but they don't know what's going on behind the scenes. And yet, God still uses you. He still uses me. He still uses us. He uses earthen vessels to get His word through. See, it's not as much about us and what we do. It's His word. It's His spirit. His word won't return void. So I could have went out last night and got drunk and came in this morning, picked up a microphone, and began to preach and teach, and the gift would have worked. People could even give their heart to Christ because it would have worked. And God, for a season, He'll let you go on and He'll let you do your thing and you'll minister to people, but you won't touch the heart of God. Now, don't worry. I did get drunk last night and I don't drink. Some are like, whoa, wait a minute. What are you saying, Pat? You set me up for a big fall here or what? No. But I'm saying it's so easy for us to pretend and to carry a facade, a persona, that on the outside it looks like success. But behind the scenes, the place that you know and the place that God sees, He says, I'm going to let you for a season. I mean, just judgment will come. Let's be clear. This text says that they will pay the price. They will reap the consequences of their sin. This isn't cheap grace. I'm not soft on saying, oh, it doesn't matter what you do. No, the consequences will come because the wages of sin is death. The payment of sin. Sin destroys things. Sin destroys us spiritually. Sin destroys relationships. Anything that sin touches, it will destroy. But he draws a distinction. He said, there's people in my house that they're still able to serve. They're still able to use their gift because my word will not return void. My word is, and my spirit's going to go through. And it's still, I mean, think about it. God will use a donkey to speak to his people. God will use a whale to get somebody's attention that you're running in the wrong direction. He will use earthen vessels because he loves his people. But there's a line to where he says, you won't minister to me. Oh, I don't want to have a ministry that just cares for you and touches you. I want to have a ministry. I want to be the kind of person that touches God's heart, that can come before God and it's easy, and especially a church that preaches faith, and we believe in victory, and we believe in getting excited and passionate about the things of God, to have a sobering moment here this morning before we come before the table of the Lord to say, God, I don't want to just keep making excuses for this sin, keep making excuses for myself. I don't want to try to let just try to hide from people. I need to be honest with myself. I need to be honest with you, God. What priesthood do you want to be a part of? The priesthood of compromise? You may be able to get by for a while. I mean, I'm always shocked when I deal with people, and this has happened 1,000 times. Dealing with a married couple or dealing with somebody, working on something in their life, but the bottom drops off and I'm like, why didn't you come earlier? Why didn't you deal with this beforehand? Like, why did you have to wait till it got to this point? So much damage has been done now. And here's the thing, God sends us so many warnings along the way to help us, to lead us to repentance, to deal with that sin that so easily entangles us. But what do many of us do? We hide. We run. We don't deal with it. We think we can get by. We think we're the exception to the rule. If you're already saying, it's easier to ask forgiveness than get permission, you're already down on the wrong road. If it's easy for you to say, I'm not going to pause and pray about this. I'm just going to make this decision. I'm not going to talk to my spouse about this. I'm just going to do it. I'm not going to, meet with an accountability partner. I'm just going to do it. You're already in trouble. And God sends us many warnings along the way. And maybe this could be one for you this morning. God loves you so much that he knows whatever you are allowing, and it might not be some big heinous sin. It could be an attitude that you've allowed in your mind. It may be a bitterness, an offense that it's growing into a bitterness, and it's slowly hardening your heart, and it's a sin. It's something that's entangling. It's holding you back from running the race that God wants you to run. And so, as your pastor who loves you and is willing to maybe step on your toes a little bit here this morning to say, it's time. It's time to not allow whatever it is you're watching, whatever it is you're messing around with on your phone, whatever conversations you're having with somebody of the opposite sex that you're not married to, whatever it may be, don't let it go on. Because it will catch up with you. Judgment will come. And just because, and it says in Ecclesiastes chapter 8, when judgment is delayed, people feel like they can just do wrong. And that's what happens. When we're not penalized right now, we think, I can hide it, I can, you know, I got time. We think we can do wrong. But let this be a wake-up call this morning to say, enough is enough. It stops right here. I don't want to just minister to you. I want to minister to the heart of God. I want to minister to you. I want to be able to approach you. And oftentimes when we are involved in some kind of sin, some kind of attitude or thought that, and what do? We hide. God's still there like this. And even as we observe communion, go ahead, Rachel, come to the keyboard. As we take communion this morning, his arms are wide open like this. You're still his son. You're still his daughter. I'm not talking about whether you're saved or not. I'm not saying that you're not saved because you've got this going on in your life. It's clear that they were even serving in the temple and there was heinous immorality going on. I'm not saying you're not saved. I'm not saying you're not going to heaven. But do you want to be a person just ministering and just caring for others? Or do you want to go deeper and minister to the heart of God? He's right here waiting, saying, you're still my son, you're still my daughter. You can come, deal with this, ask forgiveness, get rid of that weight, that thing you're carrying. It entangles you and it's going to keep you from the race that God has. Give it up, surrender it to him this morning. He's not coming at you today with a word of condemnation. This is a word of freedom. It's a word of victory. It's a word that will bring such great relief when you give it up and give it over to God here today. I don't know what it is. But don't roll the dice. I know you can keep it from your spouse, but it'll catch up with you sometime. You can keep it from your parents. You can keep it from your youth pastor, your friend group, but you know in your heart of hearts, and God knows, if you got your underwear on, and there's personal holiness. So what we're going to do here this morning is communion is optional this morning. It's always optional, but we're not going to pass the little cup that has the wafer and the grape juice. Rachel's going to sing a song that simply talks about presenting our lives before the Lord and asking him to clean us, to forgive us. And I want us just to listen to the verse and the chorus, and then after that I'll give a little bit more instruction on how we're going to do this morning. But would you maybe close your eyes and just have a moment before the Lord as Rachel sings.
I see shattered, you see whole, I see broken, but you see beautiful. And you're helping me to believe. You're restoring me piece by piece. There's nothing too dirty that you can make. Wash me in mercy, and I am clean. Oh, there's nothing too dirty that you can't make worthy. You wash me in mercy, and I am clean.
Second Timothy 2, verses 20 and 21, look what it says. If you can bring that up, Josh. In a wealthy home, some utensils are made of gold and silver, and some are made of wood and clay. The expensive utensils are used for special occasions, and the cheap ones are used for everyday use. Look at the next verse. If you keep yourself pure, you'll be a special utensil for honorable use. Your life will be clean, and you will be ready for the Master to use you for every good work. It says, if you keep yourself pure. And that verse prior to that, verse 19, says, the Lord knows who are His and who belong to the Lord. All who belong to the Lord must turn away from evil. And the beautiful thing about it all is what the writer of Hebrews says, that the high priest in Hebrews chapter 4, I'm sorry, I'm all over the place with this, Josh. Hebrews 4, verses 14 and 16. So then, since we have a great high priest, he's the perfect high priest. He's not an earthen vessel, because he went through everything we went through and he never sinned, but he's entered heaven, Jesus, the Son of God. So let us hold firmly to what we believe. Next verse. This high priest of ours understands our weakness. So he understands where you're weak. He understands. But see, God wants to deal with somebody who's humble of heart to say, God, I know I stumbled this last week. I know it's been tough. I've made some mistakes. He says, come on. It's okay. I know your weakness. But what he doesn't want to see is somebody says, you know what? I got this. I'm good. I can keep hiding. I can keep covering my tracks. Pride cometh before the fall, but he can work with humility, for he faced all the same testings we do, yet he did not sin. Next verse. So let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God. There we will receive mercy, and we will find grace to help us when we need it most. And as we come to the table of the Lord, talks about in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, those verses, Josh, if you would. So if anyone who eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord unworthily is guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. That is why, and here, this is the moment of this service right now. That is why we should examine yourself before taking communion, before eating the bread and drink the wine. It's an opportunity. It's a warning sign. It's like God saying, come on. I want to bring conviction to you, not to condemn you, but to lead you to life and freedom. And he goes on to say, for if you eat of the bread and drink of the cup without honoring the body of Christ, you are eating and drinking God's judgment upon yourself. Wait a minute, this is new covenant. This is under grace. What are you talking about, judgment? It gets worse. Look at this. That is why many of you are weak, sick, and some have even died. Sin is nothing to mess around with. I don't care if we're in the age of grace. This is a church that's not full of cheap grace or Christianity without a cost. There is a holiness that God desires. It's not to get holy, to get into heaven, to be saved. No, that comes as a free gift. But after we become saved, there is a requirement. There is a standard. There is an intention, a motivation for us not to allow sin in our lives, but to come before Him and confess our sin. And what does the Bible say? He is faithful and just to forgive us. I want us to stand here this morning. She's going to sing that again. And now, again, this is up to you if you want to participate today. We've got plenty of cups on both sides. As we're in the next few moments, just in a coming before the Lord in worship, can you really come to Him today, or is there sin in the way? Assess yourself right now and deal with it. Get rid of it. And as the Holy Spirit prompts you, when you're ready, then you just leave your seat, come up and get your cup. Maybe you want to pause at the altar here. Maybe you want to take it back to your seat and you take the bread, you take the cup on your own when you're ready. But in this process, just ask God for God's forgiveness and trust that He's making you clean. All right, go ahead, Rachel. As the Holy Spirit prompts you, when you're ready, you can receive communion.
Now lives again. My heart's beating inside my chest.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh, I'm coming alive.
Yes, yes.
With joy and destiny.
Hallelujah. Yes, He's restoring you. Receive His mercy and forgiveness this morning.
Nothing today.
That's right.
That you can make worthy. Oh no. You washed me.
Hallelujah.
In mercy.
Yes.
I am clean. Oh, there's nothing today.
Nothing you've done is beyond forgiveness.
That you can make worthy.
Hallelujah.
You wash me in mercy. I am clean.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, get rid of it this morning.
Washed in the blood of your sacrifice.
Hallelujah. Don't carry it any longer. Not another day goes by. Be untangled right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Want it all stand and let's sing. He loves us this morning. Come on, let's lift it up. Oh, how He loves us. Oh, how He loves us. Oh, how He loves us. Yes. Come on, sing it. He loves us. Thank Him for His love for you. Thank Him for His mercy. Thank You for His patience, His long-suffering. Oh, thank You, God, that You didn't give up on us. We're not giving up on You. We want to step into all that You have for us. We thank You for this, Your word of healing and forgiveness in our own hearts and lives today. Hallelujah. I want you to take it one step further this morning. And this is on your own time. To receive the forgiveness of God that's where you start. Some of you need to forgive yourself too. You haven't done that yet. You still beat yourself up over for some things you've done. Don't carry, that's a sin that can be so defeating. It's hard to pray. It's hard to read the word when you're so down about yourself and you feel like God hasn't forgiven you, and your past is just so huge, and so you gotta forgive yourself too. But some of you, if there's been some compromise in your life, again, you've maybe been able to hide it. You've maybe been kind of not letting people see you sweat. You got a good outward going, even in a place like this. I mean, how would you really know what the person next to you is really going through, what they're carrying, what they think about, what they're anticipating doing, what areas of compromise they're right on the edge of? So what I encourage you to do is go to someone today. It could be a spouse. It could be your parents. It could be a friend. I would say get specific, but maybe you can just ask them to pray for you. This sermon that Pastor Mike preached this morning really convicted me. I don't want to be part of the priesthood of compromise. I want to be the priesthood of integrity. And so I've asked God to forgive me of something, and I just want some accountability here. And maybe you want to just say what it is to that person. Again, somebody trusted. The Bible says we confess our faults, our sins one to another so that we may be healed. There's accountability that really comes into play. I encourage you now, if you're on the receiving end of somebody coming to you, I want you to be like God and give them mercy. Give them grace. Don't beat them up. Don't try to correct them. Don't try to whatever. Just say, thank you for sharing that. I am going to be praying for you. And maybe it's the next opportunity for you to share, you know, this has been my struggle. But see, that's what's going to make this church a church that is revived and alive and incredible, is when we don't put up and we don't allow those sins in our lives to hold us back. Amen. So let this word sink deep within you today. Do something about it, all right? Have that conversation. But I'm proud of you, and I bless you today in the name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you.